So today we are here with Dushyant Tiwari with an AMA session, Ask Me Anything. Some of our legal advice seekers ask some of the questions, and I'll give you a little background about who the lawyer is today. Before that, AMA, Ask Me Anything, is what we do at Lawyered, so that anybody who has any kind of legal query in a certain area of specialization can actually find some advice and then can connect to the lawyer as and when required. So Dushyant Tiwari is here today with us. Dushyant is founder at Scripta Lex Law Firm, Panel Counsel of Delhi State Legal Service Authority. Dushyant has worked with cases in NCLT, Consumer Court, Family Law, Criminal, Civil and IPR. Again, he has been practicing before Supreme Court of India, Allahabad and Delhi High Court. He has worked with the Consumer Court, NCLT and other tribunals. He has also worked with cases in IBC and many, many other sections of law. So I think we are going to begin with the question answer session today, Dushyant, so that you can help our advice seekers. Whatever we have a set of five questions today that come from across different backgrounds of any kind of advice that anybody might need. So let's begin. So the first question that has come up to us, Dushyant, is, so somebody is asking, I have put up a complaint before the Consumer Court against a certain medical practitioner. My complaint has been challenged on the grounds that medical practitioners cannot be sued under the Consumer Act. What can be considered as per law under such circumstances?
See, now presently there was a judgment which has been passed by the Supreme Court. So there was a writ which has been filed by the medical association. Under that writ, they said that the doctors and the medical practitioners cannot be sued. But then what happened? That writ has been dismissed now. And under that, now there is a lot of other cases also which have been filed in NCDRC and other consumer forums, in which now you can sue a medical practitioners also for the same. So suppose if it's their duty to perform some activity, and if they fail to do so, or if there is negligence on their part, because being a doctor, it's you have to be more vigilant that what you're doing. And when you do such type of negligence and all that, so under those circumstances, you can always sue a medical practitioner.
Okay, so now they can do that. Now they can go forward with it.
They can go forward.
Okay, all right. I think that might have solved a little bit of issue for them. The second question that has come up with is again regarding Consumer Court, but it comes from across a different domain. So somebody is asking, I have got a confirmed ticket on Indigo Airlines. The flight was later cancelled on account of technical snag. Would it be called a deficiency in service under law? And what can be done so that I can at least redeem some amount or something like that?
See, in this question also, it's not that clear yet. But then it depends. There's something called DGCA guidelines.
Okay.
That is the Director General of Civil Aviation guideline. Under that guideline, there's a norm which has been set regarding the cancellation of tickets and everything. So if suppose that norms have been followed by the airlines, then they are not eligible for any refund to anyone. But if that norms have not been followed, or if the ticket cancellation against the terms and conditions of the particular airlines, in that case they can file a case against
it. Okay, so under these norms, do they return all the money to the passenger, or are they not liable to?
No. And depends. If you are following the guidelines of the DGCA, then you are not liable to refund any amount.
Okay, and nothing can be done for that?
Nothing can be done for that.
Even if it is international and you spent a large amount of money?
Not really. Because there is something, suppose when you book a ticket,
right,
if that ticket is not cancelled within 7 days, or if that ticket is cancelled 7 days before the journey,
right,
so in that they are eligible to give it. But suppose if the DGC guidelines, there are certain guidelines which have been framed. So that is available there on the nets and all that. So if you go through the guidelines, that talks about the flight cancellation tickets also. So under those guidelines, if such type of thing has been done, and that is properly following all the laws and rules and everything, then they're not eligible to refund a single amount.
So even if you go to the consumer court, it is not going to help under any circumstances. And is there by any chance any writ petition or PIL that hangs on the same?
You can file it, but then again
there is nothing going on for that.
Otherwise, you have to challenge that particular guidelines, and you have to say this guideline is unconstitutional.
Okay.
If you feel that it's violating your fundamental rights, then only you can file a writ.
Okay.
You know that, I guess.
Right.
So
right.
The writs can be filed only when there is a fundamental rights violation
right.
or something has been done which is covered under Article 32 of the Constitution.
Right.
So in that case only you can do that.
So that means if I spent about 54,000 on a flight ticket, then they want to return me nothing and they are not liable to it. And
yeah.
I am not liable
again,
to go to the
again, you have to go through the guidelines.
Yeah,
if
under the
think,
guidelines.
Yeah.
That determines
if you
the
think they have violated something against the guidelines, then you can always approach the court.
Okay.
And you can particularly mention in your complaint
mm-hmm.
about that particular guideline. Okay, look at into this guideline, they have violated this. This guideline
right.
talks about the refund on these circumstances, these conditions, and they have not fulfilled it.
Okay.
So that way you can always claim.
Okay. So I think that whosoever has asked this question, you should first ask the lawyer to go through the terms and conditions.
Yes.
And if there is anything, any loophole that still exists, then they can go to the consumer court. Otherwise, there is no liabilities of such that any of the airlines might be having. Now we have a third question, but before that, would you like to give us some insight into any of the current issues that you have gone through and it has been weird, or anything interesting, any interesting case that you've been through?
See, I do a lot of cases every day.
Yeah.
I told
tell
you
us the
like,
most interesting case.
Like 15-20 cases every day for the same.
Right.
So the interesting case was recently which has happened with us. We were in the court and there was a person whose father has purchased a plot, a land, and he was supposed to give an allotment of that particular plots. But then his father failed to do so. He did it with his the collaboration of his brother, but he failed to do so. So what happened, you know, when the father has expired, so the liability has transferred to the son. Or the legal heirs, whoever
right.
it is. So in the same case, it was transferred to his son. His son being a very poor person and all that, he was not able to pay the debt.
Okay.
So the home buyer, the plot buyers have filed the execution petition in the consumer court, because once a decision is passed, you have to execute that order.
Okay.
So he has filed an execution petition, and in that execution petition, what happened, this person was not appearing. So they came to know that he has expired. So now his son has been called to come before the court.
Okay.
He came, he said, I don't have money to pay and all that things. So now he has been sent to a judicial custody by the consumer court.
Okay. Just because he cannot pay the liability. That has been...
Yeah, because the home plot buyers have filed the application to make him also the party.
Okay.
Because
so now
his
he has
father
to go to jail for this.
So he was behind the bars for a long time. Last Tuesday only, we got him a bail in like 10 minutes.
Right.
We filed an application before the judge on the same day.
Mm-hmm.
We paid some amount.
Mm-hmm.
And he has been he is out now.
Now what is going to happen? So you are going to file the case?
He will arrange the money
okay.
to pay the remaining dues. Because there are around 5 plot buyers, I guess. So the money will be divided between both the partners.
Okay.
So they have to pay equally.
Okay. Alright. That was extremely so...
That's a mixture of a civil proceedings and the criminal proceedings together.
Okay. So that comes under criminal law
criminal
as well. Because
bail and
paid.
All that you have to get into the criminal.
Now we have, so let's continue.
Yeah.
We have a third question that comes across, I don't know, there are a lot of motor vehicle cases that are happening nowadays. And so this person asks, I was allowed a Kia car. There was a delay in the delivery of the car. Subsequently, the dealer called upon me to make further payment as the price of the car had gone up.
Mm-hmm.
Am I liable to bear the price surge on account of delay caused by the dealer?
Again, this is not a complete question.
Okay.
What happens, you have to check that how many days delay was there.
Mm.
Suppose if I purchase a car today on 28th January
right.
and then the dealer was supposed to hand over the car to me by 3rd of Feb.
Mm.
If he fails to deliver me
mm.
and after that the price has been increased,
mm. Mm-hmm.
And then suppose he is giving me a delivery on 6th of Feb.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, we are not liable to pay.
Okay.
If we are aware that he will be giving us a car in 3 days or 4 days and the price is increased, so in that case, you have to pay that.
You have to pay that.
You have to pay that. Till the time, you are not getting the delivery of it.
Okay. So, but under, so they had been, so all the papers were done. It was already sanctioned that the delivery was going to happen under this at this date.
Mm-hmm.
Now he did not do the delivery at this date, and it is 15 days after that they did the delivery, asking for the surge price.
Then he is not liable to pay.
Then he is not liable.
Not
then
liable.
He can go to the consumer court.
He can fire a consumer for the deficiency of service and for the unfair trade practice also. Because generally what happens, there is a reason also for that. That is out of the box of this. These dealers generally know that the price is going to increase.
Right.
So if they are delaying the delivery, so they are doing it purposely.
Okay.
So with that way, you can always prove it before the court.
Okay.
So they were aware and they have done an unfair trade practice by delaying the delivery so that they can charge more from us.
Okay. All right. So, whosoever asked this question can actually go to the consumer court under circumstances, as Dushyant just told us, that you, so the liability might not be at your end, it might be at dealer's end, so they can easily follow up with if they intend to do any kind of legal proceedings. That was interesting. Have you ever got a car delayed? I think that we generally get it.
Depends actually. Delay we get it only when we want some modified cars or something.
Yeah.
Or we want that car which is not available.
Mm.
But I never do it. If that car is not available, I buy the other one. I'll not wait for that.
Right. So now we go further with the next question. So this is from, okay, so this is in perspective to loans. So somebody has asked, does rejection of application for grant of loan by a bank constitute as deficiency in service in case I intend to approach the consumer court?
No, it's not a deficiency in service, because as we all know, this loan basically depends upon a lot of factors.
Right.
So when you're taking a loan, suppose you don't have the civil liability or you don't have the civil background to pay the amount.
Right.
Or the document which you are producing are not sufficient for you to give a loan. So bank will always refuse it.
Okay.
Because at the end, the bank want the money back.
Mm-hmm.
And for that money, they want some proper guarantee.
Right.
And if their guarantee is not getting fulfilled, so they can always refuse to.
But if they have, they can provide a certain kind of guarantee, maybe with an asset or anything, then.
But it still depends upon the bank, that how can you give that.
Okay, so if the bank says, okay, you gave us, so you're guaranteeing over land, that you want a loan of 1 crore and the land might cost, I don't think so that they take 1 point, so what is supposed to be the guarantee? 70 lakh, the land costs 1.5, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then still the bank can refuse to give you the loan?
They can refuse. Because again, that depends upon other factors also.
Okay.
Suppose this person might be having a previous loan which has been delayed paid,
okay,
or there was any default, or if suppose he has already taken some loan somewhere. So in those cases, he can always delay it. So it's not compulsory for a bank to give a loan to everyone.
Right.
So there's no deficiency in service.
Right. So even if they want to refuse a loan to anybody who might be fulfilling everything, then also the bank can say, actually,
yes,
no, we don't want
to
provide it.
If the bank, suppose they increase the rates, which are against the guidelines of RBI, or they, arbitrary add some additional cost to your loan, or deduct 2-3 extra EMIs in 1 month, where they don't have to do it, in that case, you can approach.
Okay.
But not before taking any loan. So that is not a deficiency service, not even an unfair trade practice.
So whosoever asked this question, I think that banks know what they are doing, I think, and they cannot be,
held liable for,
such things.
So
they might have, actually he should go back to the bank and he can ask the question, right? And they would be providing him the feedback for the same.
They will do it.
Yeah. So rather than going to the consumer court or trying to approach any legal advice, that is what Dushyant is suggesting, that you can actually go to the bank and simply ask them what will be the major
reasons
so that you can overcome the same
yes.
thing and come back asking for a viable loan agreement of sort come under that. So Dushyant, we know that we see you your practice areas scale across a lot of legal aspects. So tell us something, you go through, maybe you've done criminal law as well, do you practice?
Yeah.
So, criminal might seem gruesome to most of us, or it seems interesting for some reason that, what really happens in criminal law, because with intellectual property, you always know that it's corporate bit, what is going on, NCLT tribunals work the same way.
NCLT tribunal works in a different way.
Okay.
NCLT is something new actually.
Hmm.
So I'm practicing from the time the NCLT came into picture, December 2016.
Right.
So from that time I'm into IBC things.
Okay.
So my first case was filed in NCLT Delhi, but at that time there was a single NCLT in Delhi and Punjab and Haryana.
Right.
So when I have filed my case, just after that they got separated, and now we have a separate NCLT in Chandigarh.
Okay.
So my case was transferred to Chandigarh, NCLT.
Okay.
So I think the NCLT completely works in a different way.
Okay.
It's not the other courts, it's not the other thing, they are time bound, they are fast, they are more efficient.
Okay.
And even forget about the infrastructures and all the things which is there in the NCLT and all the issues which we face in the courts, but otherwise the work is very fast there.
Okay.
And you get a relief very easily.
Okay. And why would that be? What is the reason that NCLTs are able to work faster?
Because as per the IBC, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, and even as per the rules, they have a time framework that they have to finish the proceedings in this much time. If the matter is admitted, should be decided in this much time. If the CIRP, that is corporate insolvency resolution process, is started and RP is appointed a resolution professional, so he will be having a particular time guidelines that he has to work in this much time. So all those things are very different, which we don't follow it, because we all know that once a matter is filed, no matter civil, criminal, family, whatever it is, it keeps on going. It takes time to finish those matters, even in the consumer courts also now. So with this, the NCLT works a bit different way.
Right. But NCLT works faster, but that is what I was asking, that criminal law seems, we don't really know much about what goes behind, because generally people work on, disputes that happen not very, very similar to, anything criminal. So tell us something about criminal law, enlighten us more about it. What are the... maybe an example, or maybe what really goes around when it comes to field of criminal law. Criminal lawyers are supposed to be dreaded for some reason in the market, but we understand that it belongs to a very, very different domain than what we see legally.
It's not like that, but there's a perception about the
right.
when it comes to a criminal law.
Exactly.
What happens when someone is found with some offense or something which covers under the IPC and CRPC and all that thing.
Right.
At that time, the people make a picture in the mind that this person is guilty.
Right.
But if you frankly talk about the things, it's very different. There are a lot of times when the people get, arrested without any reason. They are not even involved in that. And there are times when, it's called mens rea and actus rea in IPC, you must have heard about it, mental state and action.
Right, right, right.
So those things you have to determine, that is very different actually when it comes to criminal law.
Right.
And see, when you talk about the civil cases and all that, it's limited to a very small world.
Right.
It has a big procedure, the civil procedure, it's very big and very tough. Actually, I can tell you that.
Right.
But when it comes to criminal, it's very broad. Because you have to look into a lot of things when it comes to criminal thing.
Right.
You will go to your IPC, then you'll go to CRPC, then you'll come to Evidence Act.
Right.
You will check all that. And with that, you will come to a conclusion that whether this person is guilty or not.
Right.
and then you have a chief, you have a cross, you have all the other exhibits and all these things.
Right.
So it gets a bit tough job, but it's okay.
Okay. So ground reality is a little different from
what we see actually and what we see in the media and all that things.
Right.
So basically, what I personally feel that in criminal law, the main things, the basic things which are very much required and needs to be very soundproof is the charge sheet.
Right.
And the FIR which has been filed.
Right.
So the charge sheet is something which everyone rely upon.
Right.
And the charge sheet consists of everything.
Right.
Even the other things which takes place, suppose the panchnama is there,
mm-hmm.
or some evidence which you recover from the accused,
mm-hmm.
or some of those recoveries and all that are very important.
Right.
So, though basically the same thing, the police role in the criminal law is very much important.
Right.
If the police is not functioning properly, so it's mm-hmm. all bad.
Okay.
So that's a different thing actually. But what happened in civil cases and all, we all know,
mm-hmm.
if someone has a dispute, they can easily approach the court,
right.
ask for their land or piece of land and all that things.
Right.
So that's a different thing.
Okay, so apparently criminal law is not all what we think about. It's just not about violence, but there comes a lot of other aspects with it. Okay. So Dushyant, here we are with our last question. We sorted some questions for you so that, you know, it comes from across domains.
Mm-hmm.
So this one is the last one. Somebody is asking, can consumer forums adjudicate disputes involving scale of pay?
No, they cannot.
Okay.
Because, see, it's not covered under the definition of a consumer.
Okay.
First of all, there's no services as such. If you have any issues with the scales of pay and all that, so it depends. Suppose if you're working in a central government office or something, so you can always approach central administrative tribunal,
right.
that we have. If you're working under a state government bodies, so you can always approach high court for the same.
Right.
But it's not a deficiency of service or something which is covered under the Consumer Protection Act.
Okay.
So if you basically talk about the consumer protection, so the scales, pay scales and all that are never covered.
But when we talk about, what examples we took right now were government-based examples. This is related to government employees, but when we talk
See,
about...
See, it's about the private also. Suppose
okay.
you're working in a school,
hmm.
that's a private school, right? So, but it governs by the rules and regulations of state body.
Right.
So you can approach high court.
And what about the unskilled or semi-skilled labor or maybe...
See, that is, for that you can go to labor court. You can go to labor court for that.
Mm-hmm.
See, for every time, it's not compulsory to come to consumer court,
right.
frankly speaking.
Right.
Suppose if someone is not giving you money, or if they're not paying you any amount,
mm-hmm.
so you can always file a recovery suit against it.
Okay.
Or if they've given you a check and that check has been bounced, you can always file 138 case against them
mm-hmm.
under the Negotiable Instruments Act. It's not always necessary to come to consumer court to file a particular case
mm-hmm.
for the same.
But when it comes to gender roles, because nowadays there has been a lot of question about, you know, when it comes to women and men and how they are paid differently, does that come under Consumer
no.
Act? No.
That is again with respect to the pay scales and all that things.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, again, you can file a case in the High Court.
Mm-hmm.
You can always file a writ in the High Court
mm-hmm.
for saying that this is against your fundamental right,
right.
because you're not being treated equally.
Right.
That you can always do that.
Okay, so it's not necessary to go to the consumer court for... and I think that generally people think, people have... So the first intuition that comes to a layman about any kind of legal action that they want to put up, what we figure out, you know, we figure out that why do people want to go to consumer court? What are these questions?
With
are
these questions you can figure out.
Yeah, even right or wrong. Of course, there are some legalities that go behind it, but it is not necessary that you always have to go to consumer court. There might be other aspects that you'll have to follow up with, and that is why we think that consulting a right lawyer is the most important part.
Important part.
Right. You cannot just go to consumer court and file a case. I think that is because it's the most accessible and the most easiest way to...
See, I'll tell you, there's one thing actually which people, like a lot of people will not agree to this.
Mm-hmm.
But generally what happens, people want to save their money.
Right.
In filing the cases.
Mm-hmm.
So what they think, like when you're approaching before the district forums, which
mm-hmm.
has a limit of filing a case till 20 lakh rupees.
Okay.
And you don't have to pay much. You just have to pay, suppose if more than 5 lakh rupees, you have to pay 200 rupees or 100 rupees postal order.
Right.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
So when it comes to this, so they think ki let's approach to the consumer court.
Right.
Which is very easy, because in consumer court, any consumer can even file a complaint by handwritten. They can write it down from their own hand and they can submit it before the court.
Right.
With the relevant documents. So generally what happens, people save their money.
Right.
They don't approach to the other court. Suppose if you have to file a recovery suit, you have to pay a court fees.
Right.
Right. If you have to file a 138 cases also, so then you have to wait for all those things. And then 138 cases is basically a criminal proceeding and it gets very complicated at later stage.
Right.
If there is no settlement, so it gets complicated. So what people think, okay, let's follow this consumer court procedures.
Right.
It's very easy. You can always Google it, find it out. And you can file the complaints, because thousands of complaints are there in the net.
Right, right.
So that's why people approach consumer court, because see, I'm basically work for Delhi Legal Service Authority.
Right.
So what happens to me, there are a lot of people who come to me
mm-hmm.
for free legal advice, but then they're not aware exactly that whether under which court they have to go.
Right.
Suppose if they have a family dispute also, they'll come to me and they'll ask me, ki, tell me what we have to do, can we file a case against them here?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the thing actually, you have to guide them and tell them which court is relevant.
So is it that with consumer courts, it takes a smaller amount of time? Is it quicker in consumer courts so that your case...
See, I'll tell you, frankly speaking, it was quicker earlier.
Hmm.
But now as the burden has increased and the infrastructure is not that good at all in the courts, so it takes a lot of time. You get lot of lengthy dates and all that things, and then you have to wait for years or a month for your matter to come.
Right.
So that takes a lot of time now.
Mm.
It's not that quicker anymore.
Mm.
So that's the thing actually.
So guys, we are done with consumer court here. So today we were talking about what kind of questions people wanted to ask regarding consumer court and what actually goes around. Dushyant gave us an insight about should you really think about before acting about any kind of legal actions that you want to take. We feel that consumer court is not always the answer. You can always go back to a lawyer, at least seek some relevant advice, and then take the right step, which saves a lot of time and puts out a lot of relevant suit for yourself. So that is what you guys can do. Dushyant is there, and we thank you very much, Dushyant, for putting those questions. Might be extremely normal for you because you see them on an everyday basis, but they were extremely abnormal for us, and we are extremely obliged by all the guys who asked the questions. Thank you so much, guys. We'll come back to you next time with more questions and with answers to all or any kind of queries that you might have in future.